Diane, can you call the roll?
Councilmember Jackson?
Here.
In the rear of the room, the mayor has called the meeting to order.
Oops, sorry.
Roll call. Councilmember Jackson?
Here.
Councilmember Silva?
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Villegas Walker?
Here.
Mayor Solomon?
Here.
And Councilmember Sanders?
Here.
Testing, testing.
Okay. We'll have the pledge of allegiance by Mr. Jackson and the invocation by Ms. Walker.
Please join me. Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing and bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening with wonderment. Sometimes things happen in this world that we just truly can't understand. We ask for your mercy and your comfort on those families that were affected by so many tragedies this past week in our country. We ask also for a special blessing upon this council as we deliberate on those issues that are of importance to our community. Help us to be ever mindful of the many blessings that we have, to always experience and live a life of gratitude. These things we ask in thy precious name. Amen.
Amen. City's attorney's report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. On a motion by Councilmember Villegas Walker, second by Councilmember Sanders, the City Council met in closed session at 11:31 a.m. All council members except Councilmember Silva were present. Reports were given to council on the anticipated litigation items. There's no action to report, but direction was given to staff on both. Stephen Beamer, contract counsel, participated in the report addressing significant exposure to litigation against the city, and Norma Villacana, community development director, participated in the report addressing the city's decision to initiate litigation. Council met with its labor relations negotiators, Ruben Duran, city manager, and Terry Brownlee, human resources director, concerning labor matters related to the units listed on the city council's agenda. Informational reports were given and direction was given to staff. Closed session concluded at 12:44 p.m. and that concludes my report, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Presentations and announcements by the mayor, there are none. Scheduled public comment items appearing under this section has submitted a written request to the city clerk a minimum of 1 week prior to the regular meeting. Because of some time constraints, we're going to move the, the Mayan Hotel up to number one. We'd like to have the county person that's here.
Jeff Lamar.
Jeff, could you come on up and give your statement? And do we have the manager of the Maya here?
You may want to hear from the citizen first.
I'm Jeff Lamore with County Environmental Health. I'm here to answer any questions you may have. Okay. I wasn't necessarily prepared to provide a overview, but more than happy to answer any questions you may have.
Juanita Trillo.
Yes.
Dear City Councilmen, ladies and gentlemen, for most of us, where we live is the most significant consumer decision we make. Our home is where we spend much of our time, and of course, we want it to be hassle-free. But move-in day marks the beginning of an important relationship between a tenant and a landlord. Yes, this is all sounds good and well, but this is not my reality, or of many of the past and current tenants of the Mayan Hotel. When we first move in to the Mayan Hotel, all is good. George Gonzalez, which is the landlord, puts on a good landlord act. But as soon as my family or a tenant moves in, by choice, not by choice, but by necessity, the next day he will start, you know, the harassment and the bed bug bites. I've noticed that there's bed bugs. It's just filthy in there, and you know, my children live there. Many children live there. There's a lot of fire exits that are bolted in, and it's just not inhabitable. It's not humane. Something needs to be done. He is just getting away with too much. When I started seeing bed bugs crawling was about the first week that I was there, and I would tell George, do you have bed bugs? And all he would say is, I'll get you some spray and I'll take care of it. And it never happened. So what I would do, and I would went down to the health department at least 3 to 4 times. And many of the past and current tenants have reported him also. But the health department goes, but they just tag the rooms and wait for him to spray, and that's all. And nothing has happened. It just keeps getting tagged. And this is terrible, horrible. I feel like I'm paying just to get bit. And he's also has not provided trash service for at least 5 months. All summer, we have not had trash service. We've had to dump our trash wherever we could, in a trash receptacle, of course, but not provided by the landlord. We're always harassed. Me and my family are always harassed with my little children. I have 5 little ones. And he's always calling me bad names. He's always trying to kick me out and run at my children. And he's even assaulted my spouse. He has pushed him, and he's even admitted it in the newspaper, because I've spoken to the newspaper, and there's an article there, and he admits this. He has so many code violations that I can't even count them. I've been to report a bolted fire exit on Friday, and I don't know if they've gone to check this, but please help. And get rid of George Gonzalez. I mean, he's the problem. I mean, if you would just please help. There's just too many code violations, too many bed bugs. It's been going on for years. There's something has to be done about this man. Or Jack, I think Jack Rafik is the owner. And please, something has to be done. I mean, there's just so many children. There's so many children there now. I mean, I know in the past that there has been problems there with I guess, drugs and I don't know what else. I think that was the most that they told me was drug addicts used to live there. But now there's a lot of families, and he's not doing anything. And it's just really getting to the point where I'm losing hope. I'm trying to reach out for any help. And this is why I'm here, to try to see what we could solve together as El Centro County. I mean, I don't think you would want El Centro to be like this. I don't think you would. I ask you, please help. Please.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, I have.
Thank you, Mr. Trujillo, for being here, and I know how difficult it is to come before the council. So I really want to thank you for being here and for the strength that you're showing. This is the first that I hear about some of the other components that have been addressed to the council, such as harassment, assault, and I believe that there's avenues to deal with that. Prior to this, the concern, the issue that had been brought to our attention was the bed bug issue. So I'd like to ask the county health department, how much of an immediate health hazard is having that significant amount of bed bugs? So we saw the video, and the video showed that there was quite a bit of an infestation.
There is significant infestation. Jeff Lemoore with County Environmental Health. There is significant infestation there at the Mayan Hotel. We have been involved with this for about 2.5 years. Prior to that, there, roughly about 6 months prior to that, there was consultation with the owner and management regarding trying to come up with a plan to address the issue. So this has been ongoing for some time. As far as a public health threat, bed bugs are considered a nuisance. They do not transmit disease, so they're just that. Our role here is as an advisory role to the city. I have a biologist that will go out, and I've met with city staff as well as the owner and management to try to develop a plan to address some of these issues, which we're still waiting on the plan to be submitted. But to answer your question, they definitely cause secondary issues. Someone that is immune suppressed, they could cause secondary infections. Definitely from the standpoint of being, eaten alive, so to speak, being bitten on a regular basis, that in itself could cause some distress, which actually you're seeing here, or the comments with regards to that. But to transmit disease, bed bugs do not do that. You can compare them to head lice.
To what?
Head lice.
Head lice. Comparable.
Okay. But they're not, I'm sorry, Mr. Silver, were you?
They're a nuisance. They're a nuisance nonetheless. That's important. So they need to be addressed. Like any infestation, they need to be addressed.
Do you have a question, Mr. Fissell? No. I will yield for Ms. Walker, then, and I, Mr. Mayor, after Ms. Walker.
And thank you for being here. And Mr. Hio, I would echo Mr. Silva's comments that it takes a lot of courage for you to be here and talk with us. I think we've taken very good notes with regard to your concerns. And if I were in your place, I think what I would be looking for is a plan of action. And I think that we are prepared to share with you some of our thoughts with regard to that. And so, first and foremost, we understand the issue with the trash service, but we think that that has been resolved, that the trash service is back up and is available. With regard to the assault and those types of issues, I think that you definitely need to be calling the police department and seeking what kind of assistance you can be provided by our police department. With regard, though, to the larger issue, and that is the habitability of the Mayan Hotel, I think the city attorney is in a position to kind of disclose to you what our plan is on a going forward basis. As has been stated earlier, this has been an ongoing issue that we've been involved in. Ms. Villacana, seated behind you, has briefed the council on any number of occasions with regard to the ongoing problems there. We think we have a plan, and if we could turn it over to the city attorney to kind of lay out those action steps, please.
Just a minute before you get started, Ms. Sanders wanted to say something.
Yes, and I thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Lemoore, I just had several questions that might assist our staff, especially our legal staff, as they prepare this strategy. And that is, while you've been working on this for 2 years, have you seen by the management and or his agent any kind of action that they've done to correct this issue?
What they've attempted to do is they have brought in a licensed pest control company to perform spot treatment. Now, that's ineffective due to the fact that bed bugs have a tendency to, once they're in essence treated in a particular area, they begin to migrate into other areas, whether they go upstairs or to lateral rooms. So the effective way to go in and treat that is to treat all rooms at the same time. Due to the extensiveness of the infestation, that is at this point in time the only probably approach that's going to hopefully resolve the issue. But to go back to your question with regards to treatment, they have listed the services of a pest control operator. My understanding is they've purchased some heating equipment that apparently, according to their management, was effective originally, but from the last time that we were out there, which was about a week or so ago, it appears to be ineffective. And it can be how they're applying it. So spot treatment is not the effective way to treat for bed bugs. You need to treat it as a larger, you need to treat the entire unit.
Yes. And, okay, and I think I have a question for Mr. Hill. Mr. Hill, were you, you said you were there not by choice. Oh, all right, would you mind coming back to the microphone, please? So you're living at the Maya not by choice. How was that site selected for you?
That is the least, it's not expensive. That's what I can afford.
The least expensive.
Yeah.
Okay. That's fine. Thank you. Then I think, Mr. Mayor, then we will then allow, I'm sorry, Mr.
Yeah, Mr. Silva wants to say
just a follow-up question from the County Health Department. You said we've been dealing with this issue for over 2 years, so and I'm not a believer of, you know, rehashing what happened in the past, but I'm a believer of learning from the past. So has there been, what has allowed this infestation or this problem to continue for over 2 years? Has there been something that could have been done differently, or that's just the way our regulations would permit us to continue? In a way of finding mitigation for this, or what can we do, or what can we learn as a city or a county?
Sure. What I can tell you, and I'm gonna answer that somewhat differently, what I can tell you is our role, as far as environmental health, we do not have code enforcement authority inside of city jurisdictions. Under the agreement that we have through the public health department, we have other roles that we fulfill as a public health department, but it doesn't fulfill, we don't have an element of code enforcement. So we act as an advisory role. We have an advisory role. So when you act about, when you're asking what's the most effective way or what tools have you been using to try to effectively manage this, I would refer or defer to your code enforcement program.
Well, Mr. Lamore, though, but you did provide information to the management.
Correct.
In telling them how they could eradicate the problem.
Correct.
You gave them particular concepts that they may utilize by saying you need to get a licensed exterminator in. It would be wise if you would do the entire unit versus spot treatment. And those particular things have not been followed through on.
That's great. One of the key things that we have asked for, and we did it collectively as the city and county coming together on this matter, was requesting a work plan. And that plan is it's essentially an abatement plan to address the issue.
Yes.
And we are, as I mentioned in the beginning, we're yet to get that from management, from the owner. And that in itself will then, that I mean, that's the most appropriate document to have so that it, you have a plan of attack that is appropriate. So they would need to contract with a licensed pest control operator to assist them to put that together. Obviously, we're there as a resource to help guide them, and ultimately, we will work with the city in approving that plan. But until we have something that's effective, that is an effective tool to address treating bed bugs, they're just kind of chasing themselves.
Let me ask you a question. You had indicated that you thought it would be a good idea to do it all at one time. What that means that the tenants would have to be moved someplace else, at whose expense?
I would leave that to your council to advise you on that.
Okay.
Okay, so we, the city and the county have been working jointly, informally, with the owner and the manager to try and get the plan in place, try and come into compliance with all the code enforcement issues, with the nuisance issues. He just was not doing what needed to be done. We kept giving him extensions and he did not follow through despite giving the extensions. So we then had to get authority to take the necessary steps, whatever is necessary, in order to force him to come into compliance with all of the code enforcement violations. And so there are certain steps that the city needs to take in its code enforcement process. We are actively taking those steps as we speak. There's a inspection scheduled for September 25th that will allow the city to conduct a comprehensive inspection of the entire facility. It will allow the city to generate the correct with the necessary reports. It will allow us to give notice to the parties who we need to give notice to. And ultimately, if we have to initiate litigation, we will be able to do so once we've finished all the preliminary steps.
But to follow up on Mr. I'm sorry, Mrs.
So the ideal remedy would be to vacate the premises and do a...
The first step needs to be they need to get a certified professional along with our office, along with code enforcement, to begin to assess the building room by room. If it's determined that all, is it 46, anyhow, if it's determined that all rooms are infested, then that's the most logical next step. If it is determined that there are certain floors or certain sections of the building that are infested, then you can start kind of scaling down your method of treatment. But you need to understand what you're up against or how extensive the infestation is prior to going in and treating it. So to answer your question that should they all move out, we don't know that until they, but if it's determined, we don't know that until they go in and assess that, but if it's determined that it is heavily infested, and all rooms are infested, and the method to address it is to treat all rooms at the same time, then that makes the most logical sense, but also on top of that, then they have belongings that also need to be relocated. Mm-hmm. Those belongings will need to be, before they take them to another motel, hotel, or another living, another residence, they should be, in essence, decon. They should be treated as well, so they don't take that infestation to another dwelling. Yep. So that was part of the plan that we had asked, is that they need to address this. They need to look at the bigger picture. It's a little more complicated than I don't know what management's leading you to believe, but it is a serious issue that needs to be addressed.
Let me ask you a question. This has been going on for 2 years, and we can't decide now if the bugs are all over the place. I mean, at the end of 2 years, wouldn't we know how many rooms have bugs in them?
Bed bugs are attracted to the occupants, to the individuals. So there are a number of rooms that are not occupied. So there may be occasions where you may not have bed bugs present in that particular room. Again, they travel through baseboards, they travel through the voids within the walls, they travel through the electrical circuits in the walls. They travel through the wiring. So they migrate fairly easily, they have easy access. So to say, again, today that everything, just to make the assumption that everything's infested, that could be the case. But we have been there occasions where we've had rooms that are not, but we've had a number of rooms that are. So the most logical approach is to go in and assess every room. If we're going to address this issue and try to then address infestation, it needs to be a room by room assessment.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Miller, a couple questions. You said you asked for an abatement plan. What's the time frame of when you asked for that abatement plan?
We asked for that, I want to say it was earlier this year. I don't have my notes in front of me, I apologize. I want to say it was earlier this year. We asked it to be submitted within, I believe, a 30-day period. They failed to do that. At that point, an extension was granted. At that point, they came back with a method of treatment, the chemicals that would be used. It wasn't a plan. At that point, they were given another deadline to submit, and that's kind of where it's at. I have not received, I don't believe the city's received a plan, and then it's been discussed through your council.
Would
must be a kind of name.
Okay.
She might be able to share the dates. Sorry.
Back in March of this year, actually January of this year, there was a letter sent by the Public Health Department to the property management in San Diego, basically stating that there's a problem with infestation. Then in March, there was another letter sent basically asking, where are you at? And finally in August, that was the final communication the Public Health Department had with the property owner asking for that plan, for that work plan. And we've also met with the property owner and the manager of the site to go over exactly what needs to be included in that work plan. So we gave them 30 days. They requested an extension. As of today, we have not received anything.
They asked for the extension after the 30 days.
After the 30 days, yes.
And that extension was granted.
Basically, basically what they said is we're working on it. We need some more time. There was no deadline put in place. But between then and today, we've had several complaints about the building.
And Ms. Villacani, probably a question for both you and Mr. Lamore. In your opinions, are the ownership and the management of this facility, are they being evasive? Are they cooperating? It seems like there's a long period of time here where we're not getting the correspondence between the parties. And I'm just wondering, is that a stall tactic or?
I think the main problem is that the cost of the abatement. When we originally requested a plan of attack, we received a one-page plan of attack, which did not meet what we needed. So that's when they went back to the drawing board and they requested additional time. Just like Mr. Lamore mentioned, the bed bugs keep traveling wherever there's an occupied unit. It seems like they travel to that unit. So there's no way we might inspect a unit today and there's no bed bugs, but as soon as it's occupied, you know, they may travel. And I know that the manager of the property who's here in the audience is trying to do the abatement on a room by room basis. But they're doing the abatement in-house. They're not contracting out with the licensed contractor.
So the manager is here, because I thought you said that they weren't here. Is somebody?
The manager is here. Huh?
Oh, okay.
In the audience.
I guess a follow-up question for maybe Mr. Lamore would be able to answer this better is when our mayor asked the question about the abatement of the entire property, and your response was that some rooms might be infested, some might not, but then later on you're saying that these travel through electrical wiring and such. Based on the level of infestation of this building, is it your opinion that really there is no treatment except to do the entire building? If there's, let's say out of 48 rooms or whatever it is, there's two or three rooms that aren't technically infested, and you treat everything else, doesn't that just drive those to the two or three rooms that aren't infested currently when you inspect them?
Not necessarily. Again, I'd look at it at a licensed contractor coming in and actually assessing it to determine if, let's say for example, you have 10 rooms on various floors. You can set up a treatment method where you're treating the adjoining rooms as well as the room above and below, and really try to isolate that if they're not infested, trying to isolate those individual rooms. So again, it all depends on the degree of infestation. It is a heavy infestation. So to say that it is the entire building, I can't say that until someone actually goes through and looks at all the buildings as they exist today. There's been a considerable amount of time that's lapsed through this process. So again, it's my opinion that one, they are being invasive, and two, that it needs to be adequately assessed.
Thank you.
The manager of May, are you willing to come to the
Why not?
Thank you.
And while he's approaching the podium, Mr. Mayor, to respond to your earlier question about relocation costs,
yes.
That would be the responsibility of the property owner.
The property owner would be responsible for
relocation
costs?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, sir. They may need your name for the record, right, Ben?
My name is Jorge Alberto Gonzalez. I'm the general manager for the Mayan Hotel.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for being here, and thank you for coming to the microphone. These are very disturbing facts that we're hearing from the council. We've been hearing for quite some time.
I understand everybody, and I'm very concerned. When I first got to the building 2 years ago, I got off the service. I was in the Army 27 years. And I got off the service. I took off for 2 years because I was deployed. And I came back. The first thing I saw, there was a lot of drugs. There was a lot of fights. There was people getting beaten up. I got into a lot of fights there. I kicked people left and right. I went in hardcore. We even have security that wasn't even paid. Jack, it's stingy. He's very stingy. He waits to the last minute to do everything. I was the one that pushed, you know, that pushed him to do something about it. Because I was sorry for these people that were living there. Because I got beaten, and then my daughter lives with me. So I understand where they're coming from. But the reason people didn't say anything about the bed bugs is because they were moving drugs. If you let me move drugs, The bed bugs bite me. I don't care. That's the way they were looking at. I kicked a lot of people out, and it was true. I went in with hardcore, okay? And people that do drugs right now, I kick them out. I don't like no prostitution, nothing. The issue about bed bugs, what Jack is doing, he's doing it like, he has me with a heat machine, okay? The heat machine is a very powerful machine. It's this one right here, so you guys want to see it.
But it isn't working, sir.
I got signed papers from the first floor that were inspected by Orkrin, and they didn't have bed bugs, and the tenants from that room signed it that they didn't have bed bugs. The only person that didn't allow me was the lady right there sitting there. She does not allow me to do, check on her room. She does not, she's always been pissed off with me. When she got in there the first time, she had only 100.
You're going to maintain decorum. You're not going to go into name calling.
No, I didn't call no names. The lady I said, okay?
But you're not going to be derogatory about her.
I am not being derogatory. What I said when they came in, she said I don't know the word she used right now, but they only came with $158. I took him in because I was sorry for the little kids. Now I feel sorry for the little kids. And I bought him some bikes for the little kids so they can play. And I bought a basketball court for the kids. She started calling me names, like being a pedophile and stuff, and I didn't like that. So I took the bikes and threw them away. I didn't like that. I left the basketball court because I like to play basketball. Then just recently the lights went out and she went out at me and she started calling me real bad names. I mean, calling me that I was bringing prostitutes when my daughter lives there, my girlfriend comes and sees me. You know, so it's a tenant and resident. I don't know what she has against me, but
so,
it's not like that.
What you're Mr. Mayor. There's a management and tenant conflict going on.
Hey, I can exactly.
Yeah.
Whoa, please. The issue is...
Bed bugs.
Bed bugs.
Yeah. Roger that.
Let's stay on point.
Roger that.
Yes.
Okay, so what I'm doing right now, he told me that to go to each room, we made a hole in the room, we put the heat machine for 6 to 8 hours, and it kills everything, okay? But he's right, they go through the cracks. He's right. But I seal the cracks with caulk, and I take the outlets, and I cover them with tape. I make sure that nothing gets out of there. All the rooms that I did downstairs, they all told me they didn't have bed bugs. You know, and upstairs, I checked them, they don't have bed bugs. I mean, they're gonna come and do an assessment again, and we're gonna check it. And if they do find them, I'm gonna take action. You know, and I'm gonna tell Jax, we need to do something. Because Jack is like, I'll do it, like he says, we want an extension. Don't give it to him. Bottom line. Don't give him an extension, push him, because that's the only way you get answers from him.
Well, I think that you heard that our city attorney, we're done. We're moving forward with this 2.5 year odyssey.
And I think it's too long.
Excuse me, of waiting. We're moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
We have a plan of action to be on site September
25th.
We're gonna do an assessment of 10 rooms initially.
I believe it's 10 rooms at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll just take it from there.
Roger that.
Yeah. Okay. And I think the message from the council to the owner is that this is totally unacceptable.
It is, and I do not understand.
We expect action, and if action is not forthcoming, the city will pursue very strongly every legal avenue to remedy this, but this has to be taken care of.
And you are here in the capacity of a representative of the owner of the property, correct?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Yes, so I am, and I already told him.
You will be able to convey our...
Yeah, he's in Ukraine, of all things. You know, and I'm going like, he has money to go to Ukraine, but doesn't have money to fix this issue.
Last I checked, there are phones there, so you may want to give him a call, letting him know that.
Yeah, he told me that if I needed to call San Diego, and that I wasn't going to be able to get a hold of him. So I don't know, he's going to be back in about two weeks or something like that. That's what he told me.
Well,
but as Ms. Walker said, you have the authority to act in his behalf.
The authority to act on his behalf in the building, yes. The authority to take action as to buy something big like that or to put any monetary, he takes care of all the money.
Okay. But the inspectors are coming out on the 20th.
I'll be right there.
Okay.
I'll be right there, ma'am. Okay. Anything they want, like I've always been cooperative with them. You know, they ask me this, here it is. I don't hide anything from him. He wants me to hide things. I don't do that. Because, you know, I mean, one thing I don't do, my mother told me, don't lie.
Okay, then.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Ms. Trujillo, anything
else?
Yeah.
Should I go up?
Yeah.
Two minutes
and close it. Yeah. Can I speak here or should I go up?
You have to come up, but this is not an argument. Okay, then, thank you.
Is the manager, would the gentleman have a seat, please?
Oh.
I wanted to speak on the
machine.
The heating treatment that he did. I would like to say that he never, ever gives a 24-hour notice, and he always throws whoever they're doing a treatment on out to the street. He'll never provide a place like the day room. There's a day room, but he doesn't turn on the AC. He doesn't say, oh, okay, this is a whole day process, so you can sit here for most of the day or for 4 hours. No, he just throws you out like that. When they made the hole for the heating treatment, he never gave a notice. He just made a hole. And the only reason I knew is because the drywall fell on my head when I was getting something from a cupboard that was right next to that area. And he never gives a 24-hour notice. And he is very, very combative and really rude.
So you said that there's a hole where the heat treatment was applied?
Yeah.
So there was a heat treatment applied to your
residence? Yeah, but it did not work.
Okay.
And he never, and I let him in. He says I don't let him in. I let him in. Paul Johnson could tell you. He's been in my room many times. Many, many times.
Well, okay, can I say something? I think,
Silver.
I think that, first of all, you know, I'm just speaking for myself. You know, for me, is I'm not in a position, and it's hard for me to make judgment on personal dilemmas going on between two individuals because I don't know. Mm-hmm. You know, you have your side of the story. There's another side of the story there. I don't know. But what I will tell both of you that I would expect that there's no retaliation from either side as it relates to working together to solve the matter. I would expect that we're able to handle this in a way that works for everyone, and we find a resolution for this, and that there's no consequences to you or to the other side as well.
Because I have five little ones, and
I think,
and there's more. There's more upstairs, and there was just like.
Well,
thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. I think the bottom line here is that the city has gotten to a point where we're not going to be taking this anymore. The two-year period is far too long, and we will make the necessary adjustments to get something done right now. Yes, sir. For those of you that, I'm sorry, but you can't speak to us from back there.
You have to come to the mic.
You have to come to the microphone.
And for those of you who have spoken, there's a blue slip back there. We need for you to fill it out.
Yeah, my name is Michael Urias. I used to do the maintenance at the Mayans for the last three to five years off and on. Ms. Sanders, how you doing?
Fine.
A lot of the problem was we did have one tenant come in here that was infested with the bed bugs. When the pest control people came in and the county came in, they gave me a list of what we needed to do. And a lot of it was take all the baseboards out, take all the furniture out of there, and take it outside. And then there was a process that we had to do, and we had it under control. Now, Jack is a good guy. The owner, he's a really good guy. He spent like $3 million in this place to renovate this place. And it's a nice place. A lot of the managers that came in here, they had issues themselves, but we did have it under control. Now, a lot of these guys, the managers that come in here, I'm not going to say any names, but for some reason, they didn't want to do it. I don't know if it was the cost, but basically it's just that we did have it under control. But a lot of managers didn't like the way I didn't like the way I had to do things, is because they thought maybe I was going to be the manager there. I just wanted to do the work. I had a place to live downtown. Free rent, a couple dollars after that. All I would do is just keep it under control. But a lot of those managers, like the current manager right now, for some reason he didn't want me there. But it was under control. It can be controlled, but there is a process to do it. But not doing anything and berating some of the tenants because they've had some problems, but it can be controlled. And I've talked to Jack about it, and it is a process, and there's some people that are on the lower end of the income scale, but it can be controlled. It can be taken care of. It's a nice motel. He did spend a lot of money on this place, and it is really nice.
Okay, then.
But
it
can be controlled.
I want to thank you, sir.
And staff is going to be doing that on the 25th of September.
Okay.
To ensure yeah. The statements you just made, Mr. Yunus.
Yeah, it can be controlled. Okay. It's just
And as Mr. Silva said, we don't want to get into these personality clashes to be going on. So please don't go there with your conversation.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Okay.
Thanks.
I think Ms. Fiacano was going to give you a more detailed update.
Okay.
Just one thing that I want to reiterate is that the plan of attack is very important, because if you abate the bed bugs and then you have tenants who come in carrying the bed bugs, that's going to create the problem again. So that's why we need a plan of attack from the property owner as to how they're going to handle those new tenants to make sure that they're not bringing in their bed bugs. And that's also very important, and that's what we've been waiting. So on Wednesday, we're going to inspect 10 rooms, the first 10 rooms on the first floor, and we'll see if that treatment method has been working.
What's the time frame of moving on past those 10 rooms? Are we doing 10 rooms and then we're going to wait several months and then do another 10?
No, our plan is to do maybe 10 rooms every week. So allow the manager to advise the tenants that they need to be out of the rooms while we do our inspection. So basically, he needs to give them notice to leave their unit.
So we can expect in roughly about 1 month.
About 1 month, yes.
Unit would be checked. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that's just for inspection purposes. That's not to abate.
That's right. Just for inspection purposes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Norma.
Mr. Lamont, you can go ahead and leave, sir. You can go ahead and leave. I know you have to be someplace.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Let me ask on the.
Are those your glasses?
No, they're not.
Oh, those are mine. Okay.
Can you tell me how hot that machine gets?
Thank you, Jeff.
You're welcome.
Excuse me?
Can you tell me how hot that machine will get?
We put it at 237 degrees. 237 degrees. We can't go higher than that because they would start melting everything else.
Okay, no, it's at 237, and for what's the duration of time?
6 to 8 hours, ma'am.
6 to 8 hours.
Mm-hmm. And what we do, we have everything, put everything, like spread it, like we don't like anything covered there. And all the clothes and everything has to stay there. And after it's heat up and everything, we ask the tenants to take all their clothes and take it to the dryer, so they can be in the heat, the dryer. That way it can clean the clothes too. Mm-hmm. Then after that, I come back and I do an assessment to find out if they're dead bugs. You know, because the guy told me that he didn't have any dead bugs. Some of them will tell me they don't have bed bugs. And I do an inspection, I pick it up, and I see the bed bugs, that's it. So one time when I put the heat machine in, this guy told me he didn't have bed bugs, and I picked up the mattress like that, and it was raining bed bugs. That's how bad it was.
Okay.
And it was killing them all.
I want to thank you.
Excuse me, sir?
I want to thank you for giving us the information.
Hey, no problem. I'm here to help. I want to get rid of those things, too.
All right, then. Thanks a lot, sir.
No problem.
Do I seem to be here, sir?
No.
Okay, we're done.
What's the pleasure of the council?
I think staff is moving forward with the action plan. I appreciate Mr. Silva's comments with regard to making sure that the parties cooperate for a reasonable solution.
Mayor, as for the other items that were indicated, I want to have the necessary department heads follow up on making sure people know how to, if there is an illegal activity, how to report it. And that'll go to Chief McGinley. We confirmed earlier this week that the trash service was operating, but I'm going to have that red flag. So should trash service be suspended due to lack of payment, we'll be notified of it.
And I think Mr.
And also the fire exit issue, right. Fire marshal will be following up. All these will be going out to them by email and for them to follow ups to ensure that by the way, the fire exit issue will happen immediately because we're not going to wait till the 25th on that.
It's interesting to me that who's going to be monitoring those tenants as they come in to determine whether or not they're coming in infested with bed bugs?
Typically, that would be the role of the manager owner. It is their facility.
It's a huge pest. Bed bugs are in crevices and creases.
Okay. Then we know what our plan of attack is. Let's move on to the next item. Yeah.
We were just wondering here, if anyone needed to stand up and shake a little bit after the discussion of bed bugs.
All right, next we're going to have an informational update report by Christine Moore regarding the AT&T communication tower at 763 State Street in El Centro.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor Solomon and members of the El Centro City Council. My name is Christine Moore, and I'm the Director of External Affairs for AT&T. I'm here tonight to give an update on our proposed project at 763 State Street. First of all, I want to express my appreciation for your Planning Director Norma and your City Manager Rubin for their continued support and partnership with us on moving this project forward. Thank you. I saw Norma here earlier. Oh, there we go. Thanks. I'm happy to report tonight that on September 6th, AT&T resubmitted our plan check comment corrections, and they're currently under review by the city. Barring any additional changes, we expect and hope to receive a building permit by mid-October. Also, based on council comments from the last meeting, I've consulted with my colleagues at AT&T, and we can commit to sitting down with city staff to discuss an off-site mitigation option this week. And we are happy to return to council in October with an update on that process. I brought Sims to refresh your memory. We have both our Sims of the clock tower proposal. With your permission, may I approach the dais? Thank you. I've also brought Sims of the original proposal, which was the first incarnation of our proposal, and which would be the off-site mitigation option that would be discussed with the city if it's the desire of this council to direct staff to do so. So I will again approach the dais and give you the Sims of the proposed off-site mitigation option.
Ms. Moore, I don't recall a discussion about an off-site mitigation proposal.
Yes, in the last council meeting, I believe it was Councilmember Jackson.
Yeah, I had asked for a off-site mitigation plan to be brought back to the council for review.
Thank you. And so I've brought the Sims of the original proposal for that site, which would be what we would return to with the condition on project approval of an off-site mitigation option for the downtown core.
I'm sorry, just to clarify, you did that, Jason, at the last meeting?
Yes. No. Well, what was the date on that? When you last came?
I'm sorry, I can get you that date. And
Was it part of the discussion?
Yes, it was. During the public discussion. And I'm sorry, forgive me for not introducing my colleagues who are here with me this evening. We have Daryl Dougherty and Ted Marioncelli from PlanCom, who have also been working on this project. Thank you.
So, Christine, I'm sorry. Forgive my for not. Sometimes the words that we use, I don't get them. But when you say an off-site mitigation option, or maybe Jason, that implies that a willingness to consider other options, or tell me what that means.
Sure, absolutely. Thank you for asking. When we first proposed this project, it was going to be additional antenna on the existing tower. And at the time, under the conditions of project shape, that was not allowed. So that led to the discussion of another form of what this might look like, which was ultimately the incarnation was this clock tower that you have in front of you on your Sims. Recently, there was a question at the last council meeting of why can't we look at an off-site mitigation option? What was the reason that we ended up with this clock tower? And so, and is there the ability with AT&T to talk about an off-site mitigation option as a condition of project approval? What that means is that essentially we would look back at the first thing that we submitted, which is in front of you with the additional antenna, and instead we would look to other projects in the downtown core that we could support as an off-site mitigation option.
What does that mean?
What that means is that there would be a contribution to the city of El Centro to commit to a project in the downtown core that would mitigate the visual impact of this site.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so just so I'm clear, mm-hmm. AT&T is actually proposing that prospectively you would build this huge tower?
But that tower already exists on top of the building.
In lieu of what you have promised the community.
And then there would be a contribution to the city of El Centro to commit to a project in the downtown core. And it's my assumption that the city would work with the businesses and residents to determine what the best use of those funds would be.
Okay. This is my take on it. And so not the council's, but my take on it. I'm not necessarily opposed to the idea of reevaluating options, but that reevaluation should take place very quickly, so that if it's the will of the council to proceed, then that moves quickly. If it's the will of the council ultimately to move on to something else, that something else also moves quickly, and so that this. It's mitigated one way or the other, and we don't take 5 years to do that.
Absolutely, and we recognize that we are at the finish line for the clock tower project, but we are also able to concurrently, at least for a short amount of time, have a discussion about an off-site mitigation option, because what you're looking at on that SIM was what we originally proposed. So we can move very quickly on going back to the original option because it was our original proposal.
So that the two can go parallel?
The two can go parallel for a little bit of time, and I want to say probably mid-October we would need to decide what our, correct me if I'm wrong, decide what the course of action would be.
And who would, and I don't know whether there's enough will on this council to do that, but mm-hmm. if there was, what's the process, Norma, to evaluate that? And because I would presume that if there's a change that would have to go to the Planning Commission and council and...
Basically, the process would include an amendment to the existing conditional use permit, so it would have to go through the Planning Commission and City Council.
It would or would
it,
not?
It would. Yes. It needs to go.
Okay. So therein lies some time.
So essentially, I think what would happen this evening, if it's the will of the council, would be to direct us to meet with city staff to talk about what off-site mitigation might look like. It is a negotiation, and if it is deemed something that is worthy of bringing back before you, then we would bring that back for a public hearing.
Okay, Mr. Mayor, if I may.
Yes,
Ms. Hammond. I have some questions, Ms. Mm-hmm. Moore.
Sure.
For way of disclosure, Ms. Moore did chat with me a little bit, I think.
I'm sorry?
Did you not chat with me earlier, maybe
yes,
a month
I did.
Ago?
Yes, I did.
Regarding this potential of this issue, mm-hmm. and also I had a chat with Mr. Jackson. I informed both of them that I thought it would be premature for us to discuss anything in any great length until we got here today. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to make sure my colleagues understood that when you did call me, we went absolutely nowhere with the conversation. Mm-hmm. And I want Mr. Jackson to acknowledge that when he called me and talked about it, I said, no, if this is coming before the council, we'll wait until it gets before the full body. But as I looked at this, and I wanted to go back and refresh my memory, I may need a little help from you, Ms. Moore. I may need some help from staff. The reason that the council had proposed looking at something was to cover what we felt was kind of an unsightly tower. And the clock closure, enclosure, was going to do just that for us.
It was actually a condition of Project SHAPE that a new additional telecommunications infrastructure was not permissible at that site. Okay. So we had
but
to look.
But you got the CUP, so that in light of that, then the enclosure itself was going to also make it a little bit more aesthetically pleasing.
Right, it was a camouflage.
Okay, mm-hmm. okay. So having said that, subsequent to this time frame that now has elapsed, which is 5 years or whatever length of time, mm-hmm. We are moving forward with our transit center located on 7, which will
yes.
have a clock
yes.
and a small tower.
Mm-hmm.
And that may lead some to wonder whether or not it would be appropriate to have two clocks on two towers within proximity of a block of each other.
Yes, ma'am.
So now the whole notion of redirecting funds, that's my term, not yours, I think it would certainly behoove us to have you discuss with staff what options that would be, and then to determine whether or not it would be used in the downtown core or in some other space or use for the city.
Yes.
And I don't want us to tie into the fact that it may be just specifically for that downtown area, because I think that would limit the possibility of what we may wish to do with those funds. Now, As I looked at the one that has the, I don't know what you'd call it, the second handout.
Okay, that's the original proposal.
Is that the original proposal?
The first one is the clock tower, okay, which
the second handout.
Right, that would be the original proposal that, due to Project SHAPE, was not successful for approval.
And I can see why. I can see why we made right. that decision. So if we don't use the clock tower, it reverts back to this.
Yes, it would be the additional antenna structure on top of the existing tower.
I can see from the body language from my colleague here that the body language and perhaps some noise coming from my colleague that does not seem to please her. However, I can see why we originally did not coincide with this. Now, the option of looking at it and exploring it, I don't know what other thing you could do there without using a clock. Now the tower itself, without putting a clock in it, might work.
It could. Again, it's the will of the council. We originally proposed just an obelisk, and I believe it was Councilmember Walker that suggested the addition of a clock, which we were happy to do. And so what you have before you is the result of conversations we've had with members of the council and city staff, the ultimate rendering of what that might look like.
And because the passage of time, things have changed. And the major change has been the fact that we're putting in our transit center just a block away with a clock. However, the structure uncovered is not aesthetically pleasing. Now, I can see that.
Mm-hmm.
Where is the major cost? In the tower or in the actual?
You're talking about the clock face?
No.
I'm sorry.
If you were to just use this tower without the clock, is that a major cost for the project?
The clock is a very minimal piece of the cost.
Not the clock, the tower, without the clock. Well, I'm calling
the,
it
a tower.
I'm sorry.
The tower
the
itself.
Cover, the cover
oh, you're talking about the structure that's currently on the roof. Yes, I'm sorry.
Help me out with the words.
No, no, she's talking about how much is it going to cost to build this?
Do you want to speak to that as the project consultant?
Good evening. PlanCom for AT&T on this project. Yes, it's several thousands and thousands of dollars, this structure.
The structure is
the structure it is, and it's the reason is, Councilmember Sanders, is that those two large microwave dishes that serve the 911 capability have to be migrated over in a certain fashion. Okay. And that's what's driving a lot of the cost in that project. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, Mr. Jackson and then Mr. Silva.
When I asked for this to be brought back, I asked for it to be brought back with the intention of having the opportunity to look at a alternative plan. We have something on the table that has an extended period of time on a time frame, which I think last time we talked about was an additional roughly 18 months until the completion of this clock tower with service for 4G network for AT&T customers. The
I thought it was less than that.
No, I think
it
18
was,
months.
Yeah.
So the conversation was broached then, if we went back to the preliminary tower or the addition of the antennas to the existing tower, that time frame could be reduced by a third, roughly about 4 to 6 months.
Yes, and we do have some updated timeframes on that.
And that was with the inclusion of going back through the planning process and with AT&T as the applicant paying for those fees to go through that process. So what we're presented with is two things. One, a potential for an offsite mitigation plan that would put some revenue into the city that would allow us to do a project that would benefit, in my opinion, more than the clock tower, just my opinion, and to reduce the timeline by from 18 months down to 6 and maybe even less, and upgrade the quality of life to the residents of the city of El Centro and the surrounding areas by giving them the ability to have a 4G network on the AT&T system. What I've asked for, and I have had conversation with Ms. Moore regarding this, and I appreciate her time and the work that the AT&T staff have put into looking at this issue, is what I'd like to have is direction from this council to initiate that conversation. There might not be the will in this council to go that direction, but I think it's a prudent it's prudent to have that opportunity to look at all facts, to look at all issues pertaining to this project, and I have no problems, you know, taking a left turn or doing a redo if it's the best thing for us. When this decision was made to initiate this clock tower, there was no bus transfer station being constructed across the street, and literally, I think it's 200 or 300 feet away, we're going to have a clock tower. So whether we use those offsite mitigated funds for lighting in the downtown, whatever the project may be, facade programs for the downtown, whatever it is, there is a higher degree of benefit, in my opinion, than to construct a clock tower 200 feet away from another city-owned clock tower. And as far as the aesthetics of this tower, can you tell me the height of the additional part of the antenna on top of that?
About what we already have, it's...
Roughly, it doesn't have to be...
Yeah, it's approximately, you know, 12 to 15 feet, and it's the existing tower. We're not adding to the tower, we're just attaching to the upper section of the existing tower. Okay. So no new height.
A tower that has been there all my life, I'm sure most of the people in El Centro, to me, it doesn't really bother me. But as part of the conversation with Ms. Moore, they also would, and this would be negotiations with our city staff, there is a willingness to adhere to all parts of the secondary plan with, as in regards to hardscape of the building and any potential landscape issues that can be developed around the area. So I think we have a possibility or potential as a win-win. We can still beautify the area, take some off-site mitigated funds, and do something better with it in another portion of the city, specifically the downtown.
Mr. Silver.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do need to kind of qualify my earlier comments and somewhat to address what Mr. Jackson just said. I am open to the idea of reevaluating this, but only to the extent of what's best for downtown. And from my perspective, it should not be a financial consideration. So that whatever it would take to build this, that, and we have to have an amount to that. And so we take that amount, and what are other possible options that we can use those funds for to improve the downtown? So we come up with another set of options, and then I like to evaluate that. So if A, lighting downtown might be, you know, from the council perspective, better than the tower, or the tower may still win. I don't know.
Right.
So I'm not committing in any way to say do it, but what I'm saying is I'm open to the idea of a quick evaluation.
You know, right.
Very quick evaluation to explore those options, and ultimately it may end up being this. I don't know.
Yes, yeah. Thank you. And we can certainly, as I said, return. We'll start our conversations tomorrow with the city, and we can assume that we could return in October with two choices or possibly more for you to determine which direction you would like to proceed.
Yeah, I just wanted to reiterate what Mr. Silas.
We have Ms. Walker.
Okay, go ahead.
Cheryl.
Thank you. We exchanged phone messages today, didn't get an opportunity. I guess you called me yesterday and
yes.
I left a voicemail message with you explaining that my desire is for AT&T to move forward with the commitment that it made to this community over 3 years ago to do something aesthetically pleasing for downtown. Because at the point in time, we felt that what was important for downtown was to move in with project shape, to look at the architecture, to look at the feel, to look at things like having a major communication tower located downtown, and how that really didn't fit with our vision of what downtown should look like. I'm distressed, as you know, that it's taken this long for AT&T to even get moving on this clock tower. That it's been since August of 2010 that a conditional use permit was submitted to the city. Earlier, you sat through the discussion that we had with the bed bugs at the Mayan Hotel, and the words I heard, stall tactic, evasive, cost issue. And it pains me to think that those are three things that can be made applicable to this conversation that we're having now. We've waited a really, really long time for AT&T to step up and do the right thing and move forward with what it had committed to the community to do. I was distressed also to get a call today from a community member who actually told me about the alternative plan before I had a chance to see it. So apparently it's been shopped a little bit in the community before coming to council, and that distresses me a little bit. I think that this tower is not what we want people to see as they're coming into downtown Alexandria. It is going to be right across the street from the largest transfer terminal in the county of Imperial. And every single person that's going to come off that transfer terminal is going to see a really not very attractive tower if we allow AT&T to go back to its original design and pretend like the last 3 to 5 years haven't existed. Whereas perhaps clock tower with the clock, without the clock, don't care. But isn't there some kind of a masking that we could come up with? Something that is going to actually enhance the beauty of downtown as opposed to looking for some kind of option. I haven't heard a number. Obviously, if AT&T comes back and says we have $500,000 that we want to give to the City of El Centro to do something else with, obviously I'm willing to look and listen. If it's $10,000, $20,000, yeah, no, not so much. So, you know, willing to listen, but it's going to have to be, number one, a significant commitment on a very tight time frame. It's going to have an extraordinary impact. And I think that we need to be careful as to just what that is, because while this was intended for the downtown, maybe downtown isn't exactly the area that we need.
Thank you.
To focus on.
May I respond?
Do you mean as far as redirecting funds?
Yeah. Okay. And we've got an awful lot of stuff on Imperial Avenue.
Park mitigation.
Park mitigation, 4th Street. There's a lot of other areas that perhaps would be just as deserving, if not more so.
The Martin Luther King facility.
There we go.
Thank you. May I respond? Mm-hmm. Thank you. Councilmember Walker, thank you for your comments, and I will respectfully disagree that we've engaged in stalling tactics. This is a very critical project for our telecommunications infrastructure in the Valley, and while it has been slow going, we only get one chance to get this right. This is the key hub for the Valley for 911 communications. We route hundreds of 911 calls through that site, so we can't afford to make a mistake in our planning and engineering. And again, I know that it's been frustrating. You've expressed your frustration to me. I'm aware of the desire in the community to see something happen, and in fact my conversations in the community have been based on re-heightened interest in the outcome of this project due to a recent Imperial Valley Press article. So once we determined based on the last meeting that we were willing to engage in a conversation about off-site mitigation, I was able to respond to some of those community members and tell them that there would potentially be two options on the table. So that would be the discussions with the community that I had. So again, thank you for your comments, and I'm available for any more questions.
Well, I think this is a good time for us to be having this discussion, because I understand that AT&T is interested in additional projects in Hopeville and Brawley, and I think both of those communities have expressed a great deal of interest in how AT&T is stepping up as a corporate partner with the City of El Centro.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So we are very excited to upgrade this facility, recognizing that it's such a critical piece of the telecommunications infrastructure for the entire Valley.
I think, Mr. Mayor, if I may, I think as we look at this timeline, it's already been identified by our planning, what's the new title, Mrs. Viacana?
Community Development Director.
Okay, Community Development Director, that this will have to go back to the Planning Commission and then come back here. So that timeline is not, in my mind, going to be as tight as we're all envisioning. I think we need to recognize that there's going to have to be some flexibility here for them to look at this and look at it thoroughly and truly flesh it out in the fashion that we want this to be fleshed out. So I don't know if there is any kind of way, Mrs. Villacana, that you're able to wrap your mind around a potential timeline. If you will excuse her, Ms. Morf, that she can, thank you.
The best case scenario, I think it would be 3 months. Once we receive the application for the amendment to the CUP, we have to go back to the environmental document, because the mitigation was based on the aesthetic of the downtown. Now, whether we're able to, if the council wishes to have a off-site mitigation, we need to make sure that there's a nexus to the site. Yes. So those things have to be analyzed before we come to Planning Commission and City Council.
So that's, excuse me, if you will, that's what I was trying to make sure that the time frame that we're looking at would be adequate to truly address all of the concerns, if in fact we want to take this, pursue this avenue.
Yeah, base case scenario, 3, maybe 4 months, yes.
Okay. So we're talking 120 days maybe, first of the year.
Mr. Silva.
No, it was just, I think the same comment that the reason why I said this has to be done quickly, because I think the decision which way we're going to go needs to be done quickly.
Yes.
And then proceed. So, Norma, what you're saying is that this, if the council opens the window for reconsideration, the only way to do that is to go back to step one and go back to the Planning Commission and present the Planning Commission a set of options, and then
yes.
ultimately come to the council?
Basically amending the condition to provide the tower. So that has to be presented to the Planning Commission and then the City Council.
Okay. For Mayor, Council, for the sake of the city, Ms. Piacana, please stay there. So it's clear. But the Planning Commission operates independently in that
That's
decision.
Right. That's right.
That's correct.
So
they can say
make sure
something different than what we're thinking, and then that'll be
and then it comes back
considered.
To you.
Yes.
And if it's something, it can be appealed, their decision can be
Sorry.
Appealed, but that's another process that.
Yes. I just want to make sure that you understand is that they do take their, and whatever decision they make, it can be appealed either way. But I want to make sure that was clear to you and the public.
Thank you.
I think that Mrs. Walker makes a good point about just leaving it the way it looks right here. It's unattractive. I think it should be covered some way, somehow.
What do we want to tell them today? Do we want to tell
right.
them to go with the plan of the cover? Or
what I understand is that they're willing to move forward on a two-track. Right? You're
yes.
going to move forward and you're going to pull a building permit by mid-October.
We anticipate mid-October, barring any additional comments, but we feel that all the comments have been addressed already. So we anticipate a permit in mid-October.
Okay. Mid-October, building permit, and at the same time pursuing, perhaps with staff,
right.
an option for off-site mitigation.
Right. To present to you for your review to see if that is the route you would like to pursue.
Full steam ahead with the other, no more delays.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
All right.
It's an information item, we can't take action.
But staff direction. Would want to make sure that I'd like to indicate is, from what I'm hearing is, this is not, I don't hear that there's a consensus, so it's one, I'm looking for more direction of that you
it's
want us
direction.
To go forward and have this discussion, because you took an action. So if
yes.
I'm going to actually look for someone to say, no, Ruben, you have it wrong, is that so with that information, we'll be sitting down with AT&T with an expedited discussion of we're going to ask for their written proposal, and then we can evaluate that, and we can come back. There can be that discussion about an offsite mitigation, but they run concurrently with the review process that's already occurring with the permit, and we'll be back at the second meeting in October. Is that what the goal is, Ms. Vicana, or do you think it can occur quicker? We only have actually a week from posting.
The second meeting in October, just with a plan or with the entire amendment? That's
I think it's the what is going to be their proposal to the Planning Commission on new CUP.
That can be done, and then at that time, if the council wishes to give direction to staff to move full force with the environmental and so forth, we can do that.
Yeah, we're looking just for the options to be presented at the...
Right, that AT&T has indicated that they're supporting.
Correct.
Yes.
Is the direction clear? Then is the direction clear?
Mr. Silva.
Are all minds clear on that?
I believe so.
Are all minds clear?
My staff's minds are clear.
Okay, Mr. Silva.
Christine, I don't know if this question is for you or maybe for the technical guy, but earlier someone asked you if you had a sense over how much the construction of the tower would be, and you said many thousands, but I don't know what that means. So do you have a better ballpark number than many thousands?
Many, many thousands. I'll throw another many in. I wouldn't want to do this at the dais. The project hasn't been bid out, but it is very significant, the cost. I will.
Okay. I still want to know, are all minds clear, Mr. Duran?
My staff will be contacting AT&T for that meeting tomorrow, if
and
they can't
AT&T
set it up tonight.
Your mind is clear.
Yes, we understand that this is not an action item tonight, that this is informational. Essentially, we are here saying that we are volunteering to have a conversation and see where it leads to with city staff and come back in October to present some additional options to the council once you've had more time to review what this might look like.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next item is a informational update report by Bobby Block regarding the Imperial Valley Community Foundation. Mr. Block, we want to thank you for your patience.
My pleasure, Mr. Mayor. Mayor Solomon, members of the council, city staff, and ladies and gentlemen in the audience. My name is Bobby Brock. I'm the president and CEO for the Imperial Valley Community Foundation. And I apologize. It's been a while since I've caught tomatoes or tried to tell any bad jokes, but sometimes it happens without effort. I hope this is one of those days. I just want to give you a little bit of an update about the Imperial Valley Community Foundation, since we're neighbors just down the street and we have one of the best landlords in the valley. We're at the Rabobank building. The Community Foundation was established in the late 1980s by a group of community leaders that they were interested in establishing an endowment to benefit the Imperial Valley, to help improve the quality of life and develop a real culture of giving and sustained philanthropy to help support community projects and organizations, as well as fulfill the goals of donors that are interested in giving back and preserving legacies. It was incorporated in the mid-90s in 1995 and then revitalized after a period of nearly 20 years of not necessarily dormancy, but really, I think, perhaps, I'm going to be very careful when I say this, but perhaps a lack of understanding or real understanding of the mission of the foundation and what it can be and mean to the community. It was really a component fund that was invested in the San Diego Foundation, which is a larger community foundation. Community foundations are 501c3 organizations that are able to administer various charitable funds that are established by families or individuals, businesses, community groups, assist in restitution and mitigation settlements, and so on. This was just a single fund. Is kind of how we saw ourselves. And then early 2007, San Diego Foundation came down here and said, you know what? We've had this fund for you for about 20 years. You have a couple hundred thousand dollars. In the meantime, you've had other people from Imperial Valley come to us and want to establish funds. These could have come to you. So let us know if you want to give your money back or what we can do. And I was in the room at that time, and as they were looking for new board members to kind of breathe new life into it, of course, I was probably more fit and had more energy. I said, that's something I want to be a part of. Joined the board then, and in 2008 became the hired help and a full-time CEO for the organization. Since then, too, we've been working with the James Irvine Foundation out of San Francisco. I know that Irvine's been involved in a number of projects here in the Valley over the last few decades. And so we've grown since 2007 as an organization with a single fund of $200,000, and I'm not tooting our own horn here, but just to say that we've grown and kind of figured out who we are, is now we have just under 30 funds that we manage and approximately assets benefiting the Valley of about $2.5 million, as well as we've acquired fee revenue and future asset control of an additional $2.5 million of the original funds that were invested without our help in the San Diego Foundation. We've currently gone through, and again, as I mentioned, and setting up some of the new funds, assisted some of the different renewable energy companies that are looking to do mitigation and community giving programs, as well as now we have we have commitments of over $2 million to come to the community over the next 20 years, as well as an additional $1.8 million that are potentially on the table right now that we hope to perhaps get decision on here before the end of this calendar year. And through that, and working with Pattern Energy and a number of others, just the Pattern contributions alone for their community commitment will garner about $75,000 a year in grants. And in the meantime, as we have those endowments where we preserve the principal and only grant off of the interest, we'll hope that when their installments, their annual schedule of payments comes to an end, that will be at the same level of grant-making capacity, if not higher, to account for inflation and give the fund some potential for earnings. I'll say, too, that since 2009, we've not only increased the assets of the foundation, but also granted about, a little over $250,000 back into the community. Some of that is done through disaster recovery. Others have been scholarships. We've steered an additional $1 million to other community organizations, like the Food Bank, the Desert Museum, and others that have had a need or that needed some coaching to receive gifts. And so we are trying to be a nonprofit, service or partner to the other nonprofits in the community that are looking to improve the quality of life. And so is one part of our expansion in our office there at the Rabobank building is to develop a nonprofit resource center. And this is something that we're going to build out to offer assistance and technical assistance, coaching, host workshops, as well as give access to grant materials and resources and so on. A lot of board development too, so we can strengthen the leadership that's being given to these organizations through community members. And so that will be a new service that we'll be offering here probably after the first of the year. I'll mention too that in terms of our corporate development, it goes beyond the conservation programs. We did also just recently establish a tribal mitigation program that'll benefit five of the region's Native American tribes as a result of the pattern project. But with that too, we hope that that'll establish a better relationship with the other tribes as well to develop that understanding and include them in the culture and community here as they've belonged to long before we were around. One thing too I'll mention is we kind of have a broad purpose and I think it's taken us some time to figure out again who we wanted to be and what we are, and we're still emerging in some respects. But our experience in the last few years has really grown in terms of making grants and developing initiatives around education, healthcare, scholarships, both ag, nursing, and so on, as well as to help build endowments for organizations that they were interested in their own sustainability. The biggest real passion for me right now is developing more mission support grants so that we can support the existing infrastructure and immediate goals of public serving agencies instead of having them, demanding that they create some new program in order to receive funding or be eligible for funding versus that which is their core mission. So as we take people off program, we spread and thin their resources, and I really want to make sure that we can kind of herd the cats and get everything back on track. And so that's something too, as we start preaching endowment, is to make sure that the organizations here that serve the public are efficient, that we're not duplicating services, that there is a lot more collaboration and open speaking about what we all do so we can share resources and inventory and have a better picture of our partners. And so with that as well, we've partnered as part of a grant through First Foundation, of which one of their senior managing directors, Doug Freeman, is actually a retired estate plan attorney. And in the Reagan administration in the early 80s, it took him about 5 years to develop National Philanthropy Day as a nationally recognized initiative, which has now been adopted nationwide by a number of different trade associations, but namely the one that's most prominent and cheerleads for that is the Association of Fundraising Professionals. We don't currently have a chapter in Imperial County, so a lot of our nonprofits, public serving agencies, either do not get trained on effective fundraising techniques and talk about estate planning and the other methods beyond just check writing, as well as sometimes we have to travel a little bit to get smarter. And so as that becomes more difficult, again, through the Nonprofit Resource Center, we hope we can bring outside influences in to train folks that aren't able to travel. But we have the founder of National Philanthropy Day actually involved in helping us to coordinate an event here in Imperial Valley. And I did share with the city clerk's office that we are going to be hosting an event. November 20th is a National Philanthropy Day inaugural luncheon and celebration to bring together the different community organizations, those that have paid staff, those that are all volunteer, those that prefer to be under the radar but still like to show up to things, because I know that we have a number of angels throughout the valley that continue to bless us on a frequent basis and don't seek recognition. So this is that opportunity to again, bring together the different organizations and the community to realize the impact that the nonprofits have. Again, those that are for trade associations and marketing, as well as the charitable and scientific, religious, whatever brand it is, or a subsection of the 501c code, it's important that we bring those together, again, to help measure the impact, but also as a thank you event. That's something that now we have about a dozen nonprofits on a steering committee, from the Desert Museum to the Food Bank, IBC Foundation, ECRMC Foundation, a number of others, that we thought, let's not worry about the credit. This isn't a fundraiser for us. Not a dime's going to operations. I'm taking a hit, but that's because it's the right thing to do. And we're hoping, too, that we can inspire others to give and in a way that's meaningful for them, but also to recognize those that have done tremendous things. Again, and it's not always about the biggest check. I think we measure a lot of what we do by the size of someone's heart and the impact it has on the lives of others. So we'll invite you to that event on November 20th, as well as also I'll mention that as we develop new resources to support the community, and it's not just those that we're looking to ask for money, but we are establishing community endowments here that'll benefit specific cities and city projects, and I'd like to offer an invitation to the city as well to speak either here again or else to meet with city staff and council members about the potential to help grow the El Centro Community Fund, an endowment that'll support future generations of El Centro residents and the ongoing and changing needs of the community as it matures. We're currently working with the City of Imperial for their fundraising efforts for the dog park, as well as looking at some infrastructure for to raise money for the swimming pool, as that's looking to be a multi-million dollar project, as well as seeking out opportunities in Hopeville and Calexico, and also through our partner, the Brawley Community Foundation, as we just granted through a fund that they have with us in the last 6 months, about $80,000 for that renovation of the downtown theater that they received as a gift. So we are building experience. We have a very strong board that I'm happy to have supporting me in our work. But it's not because they want to be on a board. It's because they're passionate about the community. And I think that distinguishes us. And again, I appreciate your time. I'll be sensitive and certainly want to be cautious that there's other items on the agenda. So again, I appreciate yours and the audience's time. Thank you for hearing me.
Thanks a lot, Bobby.
Mr. Brock, is that going to be the National Philanthropy Day? Is that going to be an all-day event or
No, ma'am. It'll be a luncheon.
Luncheon.
Correct. Yeah, the hours we're looking at right now, and I just put in a deposit today. It'll be at Club Lohu. They're off of 111 and Heber Road, and so that's going to be from about 11:30 to 1:30.
On the 20th.
It's a lunch. Correct. Yes, ma'am. And we'll have more information coming out on that in the next week.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Is there anyone else with any questions? Okay. Consent agenda items are approved by one motion. Council members or members of the public may pull consent items to be considered separately at a time determined by the mayor. Does anyone want to pull anything from the council?
I'll move for approval of items 3 through 8.
Second.
It's a motion by Mr. Jackson and second by Ms. Sanders. Please vote.
Motion carries 5-0.
Item 9, the public hearing for zoning ordinance text amendment number 13-06, amendment to section 29-170 and 29-171. Of Article 3 of Chapter 29 of the Municipal Code of El Centro relating to animal keeping regulations. Norma Villacana.
Thank you, Honorable Mayor and members of the Council. The item before you is a text amendment that is being proposed as a result of staff discover that both our zoning ordinance under Chapter 29 and our Chapter 5 keeping of animal regulations were in conflict with each other. So at this point, the proposed text amendments were considered by the Community Enhancement Task Force. We also relied on other stakeholders, such as 4-H and FFA groups, to provide comments, and the changes that are being presented to you are as a result of those comments that we received, okay? Basically, what we're doing is we're prohibiting the keeping of roosters within the residential area. For a while, that was a problem that our animal control officer kept encountering, where roosters were kept in residential areas and we were receiving a lot of complaints. So we're adding that prohibition to the section, to Chapter 29. We're also expanding on the animal keeping regulations for our youth programs like 4-H and FFA. Before, what we have right now is, in order to raise an animal within a residential area, the youth had to pull a temporary use permit. Mm-hmm. And there was a fee associated with that permit. So what we're doing, that one of the changes we're proposing, is to waive the fees for those type of programs for the fair. So that's what's being proposed under Chapter 29.
So Norma, just out of curiosity, I have to ask you this question. So you indicate that roosters are being added because those...
No, they're prohibited.
They're prohibited. I mean, they're being added to the list of prohibition. Yes. But do we have a mule problem as well?
No, we added mule because that was under Chapter 5 also, so we want to be consistent. Oh, okay. So basically, no, we don't have a problem with mules.
Okay, all right.
They are noisy.
I would like to thank Ms. Villacana and take this opportunity again to thank the Community Enhancement Task Force. I think we've been very successful in identifying ways to improve how the city is overseeing some of these issues. And I think both of these next two agenda items come through the Community Enhancement Task Force. And I think it's the right thing to do, and we were able to move them forward very quickly. I also want to thank the city attorney, who spent a great deal of time making sure that we got this right. So thank you, Ms. Becker, for that.
At this time, we would ask that the public hearing be opened.
Okay. Is there any?
All the mule lovers in my audience.
Is there anyone from the audience who would like to come up and address this issue? Seeing none, we'll bring it back to the council. Mr. Jackson?
I'll move for approval of ordinance number 13-26, an ordinance of the City Council, City of El Centro, amending sections 29-170 and 29-171 of Article 3 of Chapter 29 of the Municipal Code of El Centro relating to animal keeping regulations.
Second.
A motion by Mr. Jackson, a tie between Mrs. Walker and Mr. Silva. Please vote.
The motion carries 5-0.
Upon the new business, an ordinance amending section 5-1 of Article 1 of Chapter 5 of the Municipal Code of the El Centro relating to keeping of certain animals. This report will be given by Jim McDaney.
If I may, I'll go ahead and give the presentation. Since both amendments were done concurrently, and as I mentioned before, Honorable Mayor and members of the council, this is the changes that we're proposing under Chapter 5 are consistent with those under Chapter 29, which you just approved. Basically, we're adding Section C of the proposed ordinance that's in your packet. Basically, adding the process of obtaining a temporary use permit, the requirements of those who wish to have animals, raise animals within a residential area. There are certain requirements, and they're noted within the ordinance. One item that I wanted to point out on section C4, item 4, the time limited should be 6 months, not 5 months. So I would like to make that correction. That would be consistent with the previous amendment that we had.
What is the wishes of the council?
Well, again, I think that this was something that came through the task force and, mm-hmm. and staff's to be commended for seeking community input. I think both 4-H and FFA assisted with the drafting of this ordinance. So I would like to move approval ordinance number
13-27. Second. We have a motion by Ms. Walker, a second by Mr. Silva.
Are you ready for the ballot?
Yes, please vote.
The motion carries 5-0.
We have no scheduled business for assessor agency to the redevelopment. We have no business for assessor housing agency. Public comments. The city council welcomes your input at this time. Members of the public may address the city council on any matters not listed on the posted agenda. Pursuant to the Brown Act, no action will be taken on any issue brought forth under public comments. Please complete a speaker slip and submit it to the city clerk prior to the start of the meeting. Unless the mayor extends the time, there is a 3-minute time limit for each public comment. We have a gentleman, Mr. Mike Pardee. Well, Mike Brady, I saw him sitting right there. So. He takes care of that. We're not going to have a council's recess. Task force report. That's someone.
We have a community enhancement task force meeting on September 25th. That'll be our next task force meeting for the,
okay.
And then we have we're in the review of plan phase for the council chamber redesign. So those plans are being reviewed by staff at this point in time.
Yeah, we're down to proofreading.
Yes, so that would be the task force report.
I just have one, was able to attend the Sentinella Prison or advisory, Citizens Advisory Committee, and Sentinella is one of three prisons going through and beginning a process of accreditation. And so they're going to be doing a lot of fixing, painting, cleaning with no budget, as was clearly stated by the new warden. They are doing this for a couple of reasons. It helps them in the process of fighting complaints from both prisoner and advocate groups against the prison as far as abuse or conditions that they are protesting against. But it also, it's kind of a two-pronged attack because it also addresses the working environment for the correctional officers. So they're looking forward to it. It's going to be a statewide initiative that all prisons are going to go through. Sentinella's in the they actually have three prisons that have been completed. Sentinel's in the second phase of those prisons. And I believe CalPAT is following because they had some representatives at the meeting too, just to kind of see what's going to be coming their way. So that's what's going on out at Sentinella.
Okay. Mr. Jackson, were there any discussions during the meeting about realignment?
No.
Impact? None?
No, there was not. The only comment that was made was is that what they are finding is that the counties, the DAs within the counties are not pleading out. They're not doing as many plea agreements because they are pushing forward with full prosecution against individuals to send them to prison rather than occupy time in the county jails. so that it kind of, yeah, so, but what they're trying to do is they're trying to not clog up their system, knowing that there's going to be some realignment from AB 109, I think it is. So they are, they're not seeing the reduction that they thought they were going to see. So they are looking at the California, there's a private prison that they are looking at taking over, California Correctional Facility, I can't remember the entire name, but they are working with them on an agreement to actually take over their facility. It will be actually run by CDC if they are able to work out a agreement. And I think that is about 1,500 to 2,000 beds. So there would be some realignment as far as their Sentinella is doing a review process of about 1,200 of their current inmates to evaluate the potential for realignment. I think Calipat said that they are reviewing 37 because of the different level of prison. They don't have as many people that are even eligible for review.
Talk about an unintended consequence of realignment.
Yep.
Now, think of all the resources that are being devoted by the public defender, district attorney, court system.
Because there's no plea agreements.
No plea agreements.
Yep.
To send folks back to state prison. It is just a mess.
Okay. Mayor and council members report. Start with you, Mr. Jackson.
Was able to attend the El Grito. I thought it was a great event. Unfortunately, I didn't get to stay for the main act, which everybody would talked about in El Centro. I think it's a great event. Shostova does, I know, tremendous amount of work in getting that organized, and I know the city of El Centro is certainly appreciative of all the work he does, as well as our city staff in organizing that event. That might have been, I think, the last two or three I've attended. That might have been the largest crowd I've ever seen, and Ms. Walker was there also, and just a great event for the city of El Centro.
Great. Mr. Silva?
Thank you. I do want to echo Mr. Jackson's comment. I wanted to thank him and Councilmember Walker for attending the, what I have to say is probably the best cultural event in the city of El Centro as far as I can remember. We had not a packed house, but a packed field. That as you looked out into the audience, it was just a sea of people. You know, it's hard to calculate how many people were there. I think somebody, Pat, calculated about 4,000, and that's maybe right. Maybe even a little conservative number, because it was just completely full. We could not have done this without the help of Parks and Recreation under the leadership of Christy. But I have to say, Pat, Ureña, Susana, Marta, everyone, maintenance people that were there setting up and putting, you know, things away, we could not have done it without them. But it was just, it was an emotional day for me to see, you know, I kind of envisioned in the past a day where we would get that many people celebrating our culture, and that day has arrived. Someone made a comment to me in a positive way. I took it as in a positive way. They said, boy, this is really a nice thing that you guys have done here before, but you're going to need to top that next year. And I'm saying, well, wait a minute, I don't know how we can do that. But, you know, the headliner was much bigger than I anticipated. He just drew a lot of people. He stayed behind the stage and gave everyone that wanted an autograph and a picture. You know, he hadn't eaten all day because of, he had commitments in Mexico, started his day in Mexico City. And so we went out to eat afterwards. And the only place to eat in El Centro after 11 o'clock at night is Denny's. So we went to eat at Denny's. And no. And, you know, about halfway through dinner, a waiter passes by and they do a triple take, like, and then he goes and I said, are you who I think you are? And he goes, well, I'm Oscar Cruz. And oh my gosh, the guy started, got jumped up and down and dropped the dishes that he had in his hands. And, you know, and then once people recognized that he was there, then just the sea of people coming, started coming, asking for pictures and autographs and all that kind of stuff. So it was really exciting to be in that kind of environment. So I want to thank you guys for going, for attending. And, you know, we look forward to next year, because we're going to have to find a way to top it off.
It really
Ms. Walker?
It was remarkable. The vendors, too, and all of the really, really great food. The Mexican consulate and all of his staff, I think. But the different performances, they were all remarkable. I think for me, though, the biggest surprise was when Senator Wiesel sang. Remarkable. Yeah, he has a beautiful, beautiful voice, and I just thought that was that was pretty cool. Also had the opportunity to attend the chamber board meeting along with the mayor on Monday and update the board, chamber board, on some of the things happening within El Centro. Ms. Villacana is here. I wanted to thank her again and congratulate her on an excellent, excellent presentation to the Imperial Valley Board of Realtors. She was the program at their luncheon last Wednesday and shared with them all of the remarkable projects that have been going on within the city of El Centro for the last year. Also want to remind folks that the SCAG website has a remarkable amount of information that would be of interest, I think, to this council and other members of city staff. In particular, as you know, as we came into the end of the legislative session, there was a number of bills that just a flood of bills that either became two-year bills or were moved to the governor's desk. So if you go onto the SCAG website under the legislative committee agenda, you can see a matrix there of how everything kind of came to rest at the end of the session. So just wanted to remind you that there's that resource available.
Ms. Sanders.
In the essence of time, I have nothing.
We're going to miss you, Sedalia. Would Mr. Jackson, myself, the city manager, who else is attending from the city? Chris is attending. Okay, Ms. Becker. League of Cities starting tomorrow, the annual conference.
Have a great time. I have forwarded to Mr. Jackson and Ms. Walker all of the itinerary and scheduled events that would have been afforded to me, and I trust that you will do the best you can to attend all of those things. There is a lot.
There's a lot. Yeah.
I just went to the chamber meeting with you. I had a nice time. I was very impressed with the gentlemen that wanted to do the racetrack. That was quite interesting, especially if you had not heard of it before. Yeah, but that's about it. So without saying anything else, the meeting is adjourned. Let's get out of here. Yeah.